When you're given an opportunity by the presence of the Lord, when the Holy Spirit gives you an opportunity and He begins to touch your life, and He begins to deal with you and point out areas in your life that you need to change, and shares with you and touches you and causes you and brings you to a place of repentance, and you say, "Yes, Lord, I repent. I turn away from that God and I turn towards You." And you say those things to the Lord, yet just to turn back and act the same way. You've treated that which is holy as common. You've profaned the holy. We've been touched, blessed, convicted, repented. All these things have taken place. We've drawn near to God. And I have an overwhelming sense in my presence. We've drawn near to the Lord only to go home and be the same person that we were before we came. And then we come back into the presence of God as if it's an average thing. Somebody said, "Well, man, I'm okay. I mean, I'm living this way and nothing's happened to me. God's not striking me down and my life is fine." Fool! You don't poison a dog with a spoonful of poison. You take the biggest, fattest, juiciest piece of meat and you inject it with the poison. The dog comes, he smells the smell of blood, he smells that steak, and he devours it without even the notion that there was anything in there that would kill him. And he walks away satisfied, thinking he had just had a great meal. Only to find out in several hours, his life will be taken from him. "Well, man, I'm living my life. I'm doing what I want, man. I don't see any of that happening." You're just getting started on your steak. You don't recognize the severity of the situation. You don't recognize that Satan has reeled you in, and that you've become ensnared in his trap. And the devil himself is laughing at you, my friend. He's laughing at you all the way home. Because you think you're partying and having a good time, or you think you're keeping your issue a secret, or you think you're just doing your thing and putting your Christian face on, and the devil is laughing at you. And he says, "Revival? They can't even live right. How are they going to have revival?" When you come down and you weep and wail and you repent and you say, "God, forgive me. Cleanse me, set me free. Jesus, please pardon my sin." Peace we come. Do you get back up and act the same way you did before you came down? If you had a snot attitude with your mom, do you go back home and have the same snot attitude? If you were a liar before, do you keep lying? If you were cheating on your schoolwork before, did you cheat again this week? Or did you plan to cheat? Let us pray. If God put His finger on that area of lust in your life, did you go back out and still try to act like you were the player? Young lady, did you go back out and still try to get the attention of the boys? Can I tell you something? It's profane. Can I tell you something? Listen to me. Repentance is not walking to an altar. It's not crying. It's not even asking for forgiveness. Repentance is none of that. Repentance is turning away from the thing that you were doing before that was breaking the very heart of God. If you're a backbiter, if you like to talk about people, did you come down and repent, ask God to forgive you, and get up and keep talking about people? The Bible says it's one of the things that God hates, sowing strife.
Christian repentance, there's a brokenness in your heart because you've sinned against God. You've broken the heart of God. You've treated the things that are holy as if they were common. And you have a recognition that before God, you are undone. You are in danger of judgment. You recognize that your sin is what nailed Jesus to the cross. Nothing more, nothing less. Not, what about that guy? It's not about that guy. It's about you. It's about your actions. We don't have time to be cold anymore. We don't have time to be lazy anymore. You can't fix your prayer life when you're standing at the judgment seat. It'll be too late. You can't repent of your sin issue when you're standing at the judgment seat. It's too late. So many young people, you're like an ostrich with your head in the ground. You act like it's not there. You act like the sin issue is not a sin, it's a problem, a challenge. I'm working on that.
And if you and Mark,
as if repentance was like building a house. It's a change of heart. The problem with most of us is we're just like the prodigal. We've got to be down eating pig slime before we realize that what we've done has totally ruined our life. Isaiah 6, verse 1. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord on a throne high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above it stood seraphim, each one had six wings. With two he covered his face, with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. A six-winged creature, supernatural being, flying around the very throne of God. And it didn't even dare look at God. It kept two of its wings over its eyes at all times. A being that in stature could grab you and I and tear us in half in an instant. Would not even look at God. Because of the holiness. The majesty. The brilliance. Of his being. It says, and one cried to another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory.
This is the air I breathe.
And the posts of the door were shaken by the voice of him who cried. And the house was filled with smoke. So I said, woe is me, for I am undone. Because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. He said, God, it's bad enough that my life is not in order, but look at the people around me. Their life's not in order either. Dear Jesus, we're in need. That word undone literally means cut off. It literally means destroy. When you get in the presence of the Lord, when you sense his presence, do you ever think that way? Do you ever think, God, I don't deserve you.
I'm desperate for you.
God, I'm destroyed without you. I'm lost, desperately lost without you.
And lost without you.
Are you lost without him? Are you really?
This is the air I breathe.
Do you know what it means to be desperate?
This is
Do you understand desperation? Desperation is nothing else is gonna do at all. I would die if I don't have this.
Living
desperate for you.
Me.
We sing songs because the sound is good.
This is my daily bread.
Yet our heart doesn't agree with the words our mouth speaks.
This is my daily bread.
Do you understand?
Just to have one word.
Do you understand?
Person.
Do you understand?
You speak to me,
let me make it very clear if you haven't to this point. Your lukewarm lifestyle will damn you to an eternity in hell. Jesus said, be hot or cold. I'd rather you be hot or I'd rather you be cold. If you're lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Are not going to heaven, folks. Yet you think that you're hot on fire for God when you've got compromise in your life. You think you can backbite and sow strife and act up, act a fool to your parents and cheat on this test or cuss over here and like it's okay. Listen, every day, every moment you live and you go through your life living your life as the person you know that you're not supposed to be. Doing the things you know you're not supposed to do. It's a day that you will never get back, my friend. Folks, if we're going to serve Jesus, if we're going to do this, if we're going to be Christians, dear Lord, let's be the real thing. My God, let's be the real thing.